Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Global Jeans founder, Nicole Boyce.
Oh, of course, sorry. I have just, like, stuff all over the place. I'm sorry.
Hello. Welcome, everyone. Can you believe? Eighth annual. Woo! Unbelievable. I just wanted to do a quick little hands or stand-up. So for the freshmen, the newbies here, I think that we had a ton. Hopefully you had an awesome night last night. Where are you? Raise your hand. Welcome. And then for our alumni, who's been here all 8 years? Where's Austria? Carrie? Wendy? Oh my God, 7. I know I met some of you. 6? 5? 4? Nice. 3, 2, 1. Yay. Okay, well, there's still people coming in. So welcome. It's been quite a year since we saw many of you last. Global Jeans, as you know, has been building towards a transformation with the intentions of delivering you all more value. We're building out a more relevant programming. Thank you to everyone who's been involved in the agenda this year, and a special thanks to Maureen MacArthur-Hart. We're building out more, we are building out programming, greater support to help all of you as you navigate your road ahead. We hope that the next few days, as always, exceed your expectations and that you walk away more informed with clarity as to what all of your next steps will be. As Global Jeans heads into the second decade, we want to take this opportunity to thank each and every one of you. This is really important. We wanted to thank you for helping build what has become Global Jeans today. We want to thank you for your involvement, your insights, your participation, your commitment, your openness and honesty as partners, and your willingness to stay the course with us as we continue to support our efforts, all of you, through it all. That commitment from so many of you has gotten us to this important point now. And as we look ahead, we do so with excitement, a new energy, and with a renewed commitment and expertise as we work together to support families affected by rare disease the world over. A big part of this enthusiasm, and I swear to God, I'm really happy, comes with the announcement of Global Jeans' new CEO, Kimberly Hogstead. An individual who brings to our organization passion, compassion, expertise, a track record of impact, growth, and success, and happens to be a rare caregiver. I'm personally excited for each of you here this week to meet Kimberly, so please, hopefully, you can make a point of doing that. And also reacquaint yourselves with our amazing, incredible team. They've done an extraordinary job today for this event. We're very proud of what we've built with your help, but we know that there's still so much work to be done. New partnerships and collaborations to build, and new patients and advocates to support wherever they reside, wherever you reside. We will be moving forward with intention. We'll be working mindfully and openly to continue our support for you, for patients everywhere. Thank you so much for your trust, for allowing us to serve you, and for your confidence that we can and will continue to bring value to everyone that engages with Global Jeans. Thanks, you guys. With that, I'd like to welcome to the stage my friend, colleague, Global Jeans Chairwoman of the Board, Wendy White.
Thank you, my friend. And yes, there is a lot of excitement surrounding Global Jeans right now, and we look forward to the next stage of the evolution of this amazing organization. I would like to pause for a moment and thank you for your vision in founding Global Jeans over 10 years ago and your incredible passion in building this organization that now touches millions of lives. I look forward to continuing to partner with you on the board of directors. As many of you know, Global Jeans has been growing and changing rapidly over the last several years. We've nearly doubled in size. We've sought out new expertise and team members to enhance our existing programs and launch new services to help support you as more responsibilities fall upon you all, the rare disease patient, parent, and advocate. As Nicole mentioned, Global Jeans recently added an important new executive to the team. We feel incredibly lucky to have found Kimberly. She brings with her extraordinary leadership, management, and organizational expertise, all of which will help Global Jeans scale our impact. The board was very careful in our selection for this important position. We conducted a national search to find someone who had the skills necessary to take the organization to new heights, but who also understands what makes the rare disease community unique and special. Kimberly started her career in the corporate world, where she held a variety of executive leadership and management roles. With the birth of a son and with a diagnosis of hemophilia, she became a member of the rare disease community, first as a parent and later as an advocate. Most recently, Kimberly served as CEO of the Hemophilia Federation of America for more than 10 years, a grassroots community federation model consisting of over 49 member organizations. She has a passion for building high-performing staff, board, and volunteer teams that achieve results. Moreover, Kimberly shares Global Jeans' goal to build upon the growing patient-centered movement, giving patients an equal voice and helping them play an active role in advancing rare disease research and advocate for their own care. On behalf of the Global Jeans Board of Directors, we are proud to introduce you to our new CEO, Mrs. Kimberly Hagstead.
Good morning, everyone. It's a lot to live up to. It's amazing. Thank you so much for the warm welcome, and I am absolutely honored, humbled, and delighted to be here, and want to thank Wendy for the kind words, and it has been so much fun in this process, getting to know Global Jeans and meet the board and really get a sense of where the organization wants to go global. And also having had an opportunity to really spend some time with Nicole over the past 2 weeks. I've been on board for 2 weeks. Nicole, I think we all hear what you said today. I know we all heard what you said today, and I want to make a commitment from the team that we will continue to carry on and work with you to continue this mission and truly be that family organization for rare disease. As I was walking around yesterday and in the exhibit hall and meeting individuals, I had so many sort of pause moments, and not aha moments, but just moments of wow. Walking through the exhibit hall, I ran into an individual who I'd met a couple of months ago, and she ironically ran into someone with her incredibly rare disease yesterday, and they were literally glued together in partnership. It was beautiful to see. It was awesome. Awesome. It's family. I spent some time with Marie Rose, who is here from Italy, originally from the Ivory Coast, and she is committed globally to bringing advocacy and support for rare disease to the Ivory Coast in Africa, which is amazing, and she's here to learn, and please do reach out to Marie Rose if you see her. I hope she's here this morning, and help support. We are global. I think the biggest aha or pause moment last night happened as I was walking out to join the staff team, and in just a quick check-in, and I ran into a little lady named Erin, and she was there with her puppy, her service dog, Pine, and she was just there by herself, and so I walked up, and we had a conversation, and yeah, she told me a little bit about her condition, but this woman, this young woman, was the most poised, elegant, gracious, engaging young lady I think I've ever met. And Wendy mentioned I have a son with severe hemophilia. He's 17. I can only hope that he would have, I hope he meets a girl, honestly, that has the kind of engaging and amazing personality as this young woman with a beautiful, beautiful smile. In that moment, I had this sort of final settling wow moment for me that I knew absolutely with certainty, and I hadn't doubted it before, but it was just a settling certainty that I'm in the right place. This is exactly where I want to be. So thank you for the opportunity to be here very, very much. I appreciate it. I want to thank the staff team. Nicole mentioned the staff team. The team, you don't see them on stage, but you do see them behind the scenes. As I walked off to, last night, walked off to meet up with the staff team, and I walked in, and I was late, walked in, and was just circulating with the team. The inspiring piece I really want you to know is the team was talking about you and how excited they were seeing new faces, meeting new faces. The team here cares so very much, and we really do believe in that family. We are connected here as a rare disease and a rare community family. So thank you so much. Let's kick off our Patient Advocacy Summit 2019, all right? All right. I have the great pleasure of introducing our speaker, Susannah Cahalan, yes, we practiced beforehand, forgive me, Cahalan. Susannah is going to share her rare disease diagnosis and journey and impact onto her life. She is a journalist. She is a New York Times best-selling author of the book Brain on Fire, My Month of Madness. Susannah's journey began when she was 24. Like many in the rare disease community, her doctors could not make sense of her symptoms. And how to treat her. After finally receiving a diagnosis of autoimmune encephalitis, Susannah has shared her story and advocated for rare disease. She became has become a leader, a leading voice in the treatment of rare disease and mental illness in America. She is a board member for the nonprofit organization, the Autoimmune Encephalitis Alliance, and she's an international ambassador for the UK's Encephalitis Society. Susannah's book has sold more than a million copies to date, and was turned into a Netflix feature film. In 2009, Susannah was the proud recipient of the Silurian Award of Excellence for the article My Mysterious Lost Month of Madness. And this is the book in, or the article in which Brain on Fire is based. Her upcoming book, The Great Pretender, which I know she's incredibly excited about, explores the history of psychiatry. It's a mystery, and it will be released in November of 2019. So we should all check it out. Please join me in welcoming our 2019 Rare Patient Advocacy Summit keynote, Susan Cahalan. Thank you.
All right. Wow. Can I just say before I begin that I am just so moved by the kind of positive energy that I've experienced in my short time here. I don't know if you noticed me yesterday, but I was kind of lurking in the background, like listening in on your conversations. And I just have been, like, I just am really moved and honored to be here in this community in such an uplifting environment. And, you know, Kimberly, to your point about the aha moment or that pause moment, I just had one 5 minutes ago. There's a woman in the audience here named Emily who had the same illness, the same rare illness that I did, and she was diagnosed in 2018. And she actually is close friends with Molly, who is the events manager for Global Genes. And that's how I'm here today. So this connection is just, it's amazing, and I just feel so lucky to be here. And in so many ways, I feel sad that I didn't have this community in place when I was sick, because I was diagnosed in 2009, and that was kind of, I think, the beginnings of happening of Global Genes. But you didn't have this kind of community in place until, I think, what, 2012? And at that point, there were only over 100 people at the first meeting. And now I've heard numbers that you guys are going to supersede 1,000 people in attendance. So I just wanted a round of applause to you guys. This is just amazing. So I'm going to start with an image that came to me via a doctor at Mayo who treats rare illnesses, autoimmune-related rare illnesses. And I was at a symposium with him, and they were kind of picking out images that described how they feel about being kind of in the rare disease community. And this is the image he picked, which is an ice fisherman alone on a large expanse of frozen lake. And I, too, related to that image. I thought, you know, the idea of being lonely, feeling like there's no one who understands what you're going through, feeling that sense of frustration, you can't break through the ice, you know, and that sense of powerlessness and that kind of vast expanse. Like, I really, that image has always stuck with me. But but we'll get to that. We'll return to that later. I'm going to start with myself, the pre-Susannah. This was me at 24. This was in the beginnings of the illness that I would later kind of identify as autoimmune encephalitis, but I didn't know that then. So who was I then? Because there is very much in my experience of this condition a before Susannah and an after Susannah. I know that sounds strangely disassociative, but that's how I feel about it. So in my before Susannah, this was my life. I was a tabloid news reporter working for the New York Post. It was my dream to start working at the Post. I started working there when I was 17. I was an intern. I came back every summer and got a few bylines in my time there. I started with New York's crappiest neighborhoods, where I figured out what places had the most dog waste violations. Shockingly, it was the Upper West Side, which doesn't make sense, but it was true. And I also investigated a mysterious scent in South Street Seaport. We never figured out what the source of that scent was, but it was that was my kind of early calling here. And then I also went undercover as a stripper, seeking illegal butt injections in a hotel room. So this was my life. And I think that in some ways it took me longer to realize that something was going on internally because my life was so strange, right? I mean, there was so much going on externally. So where does it begin? And I think that most people here who have been on that rare disease journey, sometimes it's even hard to find the beginning. And I think in retrospect, I can pinpoint that beginning, but it's only with the power of hindsight can I find that spot. And that for me was an obsession with the idea that I had bed bugs. And I don't know how many people are from the East Coast here. A little raise hands here, yep. Everyone thought they had bed bugs in New York City and along the East Coast in 2009. It was a scourge. It was in subway benches and movie theaters. I mean, it was horrendous. It was basically a nightmare come to life. And I was one of the people who believed that they had bed bugs. That's not unusual, right? What was unusual is that I actually had an exterminator come to my apartment, look at it, and tell me, you don't have bed bugs. But I was so obsessed with this idea that I did that I had him exterminate anyway. Now again, that wouldn't necessarily send you to a doctor, right? I mean, that's not enough. But in my kind of looking back, I realized that's the kind of beginning, in a way, of what I would call my unraveling. What the next symptoms were more bodily. I had one-sided numbness on the left side of my body, which sent me to my first doctor, where I received my first misdiagnosis, which was mono. That was the first diagnosis that I got. I had an MRI because one-sided numbness was worrisome enough to warrant an MRI. And the MRI revealed little slightly enlarged lymph nodes in my spine, which got them to conclude that I probably had some kind of flu. And so that was the first diagnosis I got, and it made sense. I was tired, I was lethargic. I was actually kind of depressed in a very deep way. I wanted this job so bad at the New York Post. I've been fighting for it since I was, a teenager. And all of a sudden, I just didn't have any of the enthusiasm that I had kind of thrived on before. I would come to work kind of disheveled, very out of it. I would just kind of didn't care. And again, not enough to go to a doctor, those symptoms alone, and not enough to connect them with the one-sided numbness. But I definitely, the idea of a flu or something affecting my immune system made sense to me at the time, but it wasn't correct. From there, I actually emerged out of that experience of that kind of funk and depression and flu-like symptoms to a kind of exact opposite. All of a sudden, I had tons of energy. I was filled with energy. I couldn't kind of control myself. In fact, I would kind of pace around, and I remember I went to my editor at the Post, and I said, I want more stories. Give me bigger stories. I want to be an investigative, serious investigative journalist. And he kind of gave me this look like, what's going on here? Considering my past, but also I was just rambling and I speak fast anyway, but I was almost at another level. But that was kind of interceded by other symptoms, which was instead of manic happiness, there was a kind of manic unhappiness that was going on too. I would find myself in crying jags under my desk. And at that point in this stage of the illness, I was so confused. Why do I feel this way? What is it about my life that's making me feel this way? So I tried to make sense. I tried to piece together. Maybe it's the job. Maybe it's my boyfriend. I had just started dating my boyfriend, and I had just moved on into an apartment by myself. There was a lot of newness. So I thought, maybe these things are making me unhappy. I didn't think it was something internal. I really thought, okay, maybe it's my life, because none of it made sense. I could not hammer down my feelings. Then one day, I walked to work through Times Square, because I was living in Hell's Kitchen at the time, and I don't know how many people here have been to Times Square, but it's a horrendous place. It's terrible. So on a normal day, on a great day, it's terrible. This day, the lights were so bright that they almost seared into my brain. They were physically assaulting me. I felt sick. And I remember kind of stumbling up 48th Street to the Post newsroom, where the lights were kind of less bright. So it kind of calmed down a bit, but I still had this heightened, strange sense of kind of pain associated with light and sound and visuals. And that day I was supposed to interview John Walsh from America's Most Wanted. Do you guys know? I wonder what he thinks of that interview. In fact, I should track him down. I've always wanted to, but I'm somewhat scared of finding out what he thinks. I still have this, even though it's been so many years, I still have this kind of fear of what he would say. But we had an arrangement for me to interview him, and I remember he had been on TV, so he had makeup on, and it was kind of, you know, it was kind of dripping off of him. And I walked through the hallway of the New York Post on my way there, and all of a sudden, the walls felt like they were breathing. And they were kind of, you know, in and out, in and out. And then the ceiling started to kind of go sky high. And I had this almost Alice in Wonderland effect. And I was stumbling. I didn't know then that I was probably having some kind of seizure-like experience. I didn't realize. All I knew was that my world was suddenly very different from how it was before. I went to this interview, and all of a sudden I found that I could understand what he was saying, but I couldn't write it down. There seemed to be a disconnection. And I remember at one point he used some innocuous word, but I suddenly found it hilarious. And I started laughing inappropriately, and they cut the interview short. That article on drug smuggling submarines, which he was working on, it never ran, because that was the last day at work for about 8 months. That night, my boyfriend, Steven, who is now my husband, he came over to my apartment. He had known I was having some issues, and this is now probably a month of feeling off in some way, either that depression or that manic energy. And he had made me a pasta dish, you know, some spicy shrimp pasta. And I remember looking at the food and being so disgusted by food in general. And also, I just could not sleep. I just had, again, that manic energy. That night, we were on my couch bed, because my apartment was so small, you couldn't have an actual bed in it. And I remember looking at the TV, and it was that show, Spain on the Road Again. Do you guys remember that? That was with Gwyneth Paltrow, Mario Batali, et cetera. And I remember thinking, I don't like Gwyneth Paltrow. And that was my last kind of memory for, this is my dislike for Gwyneth Paltrow, was my last memory. Until I woke up that morning, that early morning, about 2 o'clock in the morning, in a hospital, in a room where one man was handcuffed to a bed, and another one was screaming and throwing up. That's what I woke up to. But this is how my husband recalls what happened. And you're gonna hear this audio that I have recorded. It was recorded when I was doing interviews to put together my book. And what you'll find here is that it's a strange disconnect on my kind of end, because I don't remember, whereas he kind of has all the trauma. And I know that there are a lot of caregivers here. And sometimes I believe in my experience, and I don't know in yours, but a lot of the trauma during the height of my illness, actually the caregivers had.
even more than me. And you can hear it in his voice versus mine. Mine is more curious, like, tell me the worst stuff. His, you'll hear.
Just close your eyes, and then your head turned towards me, and that's like when you had a seizure. Your head turned towards me, and your arms went up in front of you, totally
like
straight.
Like that? Like this? Or like
no,
that?
Like straight out.
Like a mom.
Like Frankenstein. And totally stiff, and your head was turned looking at me, and you just started convulsing, and your eyes rolled back, and you...
The convulsing, full body convulsions?
Yeah, sort of. And
was it like?
I remember it more you being stiff, but then
you
couldn't breathe.
My poor boyfriend, husband. I had to put my family through the ringer to put this together, but they were wonderfully supportive throughout the whole process, and also through the kind of opening of wounds when I wrote this book. But this, as you can see, this dark screen from here on out. Until I kind of reemerge again towards the end of this talk. This is a moment that is a kind of before and after moment, and after this moment, you should probably not trust what I have to say. Because at this point, after that first seizure, I become an unreliable narrator. Most of the things I remember going forward for the next couple of months are hallucinations, delusions, things that probably didn't really happen. So just a warning, I am unreliable, and keep that in mind throughout the next 10 minutes or so. But from here, I wake up in this hospital room with the throwing up man and the man handcuffed to the bed, and I'm angry. I don't remember what he saw. I don't remember convulsing. I don't remember any of this. In my mind, I created a narrative. I was sick. I was dying of cancer, and the doctors misdiagnosed me, and I was going to sue them. It's all emerged. I don't know how it emerged, but this is what my mind created when I woke up from that seizure and I was in the hospital room. So I started screaming about suing the doctors, which made them want me to get out of the hospital very fast. So that night they discharged me and they said, okay, well, she had a seizure. Maybe she did have a seizure. Maybe she didn't. They didn't capture it ictally. All they heard was my boyfriend's kind of description. And then they had a really angry patient on their hands. So they let me go. My boyfriend, he called my parents, and my mom collected me and brought me to my childhood home in New Jersey, where things started to escalate even more. I continued to have seizures, and she made an appointment to return to that doctor who had diagnosed me with mono, because clearly something was continuing to go on. And on the ride in to get an EEG, my mom will kind of, I'm gonna let my mom here, mom, dad, describe what she recalls from that time. And by the way, my mom has a very thick Bronx accent, so it's like, I think it's really cute.
So we get you in the car after much, and I'm telling you, it must have taken us almost an hour to get you in the car.
Oh my God.
I think I helped. You wouldn't, then you could go forward, and then you go back, and you could fall. And we didn't wanna grab you by your arms and put you in, we wanted you to voluntarily,
right?
So it was a constant. Finally, you stepped in the car. And then, as we're in the driveway, you opened the door to get out. And I said, why are you locking the...
I thought when the car was driving.
No, it was backing out. The car was, but it wasn't like on the highway or anything like that. And you said, why are you locking the doors? You think I'm going to leave?
Another side note. So interviewing my parents, like my parents are very unhappily divorced. They don't like each other. And I figured out a lot of why they don't get along based on how they responded to interviews. My mom, in her mind, probably a self-preservation aspect, because when I was doing these interviews, I was still recovering. I was still like right in the midst of that recovery. And she kept saying to me, we always knew you were gonna be fine. You were never that bad. Like, that was her response. So I'd always have to bring my medical records with me and kind of like lay them out for her to see, and then she'd cry, and then we'd have a real conversation again. And this actually perfectly encapsulates that, because she's like, well, it wasn't on a highway. The car was moving, but you weren't on a highway. Like, I tried to jump out of a moving car, highway or not, you know? But so that doctor's visit, and you'll hear from my dad, the opposite of this, but we finally got to the doctor's office. I'm not reliable here, but in my memory, I did the EEG, and the EEG technician turned to me at the end, because nothing showed up. It was completely fine, normal EEG. And she turned to me and said, I've seen this before. I see this all the time with stressed out Wall Street guys and bankers. There's nothing wrong with you, it's all in your head. This is what I remember. Again, I can't tell you that this actually happened, but in my memory it did. So I walked out of that room convinced that my mother and my stepfather had hired that EEG technician to teach me a lesson. I was convinced that they hired the support staff checking people in. I was convinced that they hired the other patients in the waiting room. I was convinced it was all an elaborate play to teach me a lesson about being a bad girl, basically. And I said as much to my mother, and her mouth fell open in this kind of, what, you know? And I just, in my mind, it just all confirmed she's faking this whole, this is all fake. So after that experience, I return home, continue having seizures. We keep going back to the doctor. At one point, the doctor asks me about my alcohol consumption. And I heard a good, I had said, I have a couple glasses of wine a night with my boyfriend, split a bottle of wine. That's basically what it is. And I found out later, because I tracked down all my medical records, that in his notes, he had written that I drink 2 bottles of wine per night. And I have to tell you, that followed me wherever I went. And so there was a little bit of doubt creeping into my story at every stage because of that mistake. Whether it was a willful mistake, because I have heard from many doctors that people underreport their alcohol consumption. But to go from 2 glasses to 2 bottles, I feel like is extreme. Even if I had 2 bottles of wine, though, it still wouldn't explain what was going on here, but whatever. I still get angry when I think about it, but it's okay. I moved on. But so after this, after, you know, getting that, these no diagnoses, I myself go to Google, Dr. Google, and I put in all my symptoms, and what pops up? Bipolar disorder. And so I felt so relieved. I thought, I have an answer. You know, the hardest part of this whole thing was not having an answer. That question of why do I feel this way? What's going on? That was so frustrating, and I imagine most people in this room have had that experience, and probably for much longer than the couple months that I experienced it. But in my limited experience, it was horrendous. So finally, when I get a name, I feel so great. Also, if you look at a list of people who had bipolar disorder, you're like, wow, great club to be in. All creative people, you know, I'm creative. And so I felt like I was in this kind of exclusive club, you know. And fortunately, it was not the right answer as well. But I did go to a psychiatrist who confirmed that diagnosis and gave me my first in a series of antipsychotic medication. At one point, my mom wakes up in the middle of the night and I'm just standing staring at her. She needed a break, I wasn't sleeping. So by some miracle, she connects with my father and they make a drop off at my old apartment. They don't actually interact, but they kind of place me there and my dad gets me. And he takes me in the car and immediately I flip out again and I'm gonna just play with my dad, who has a Connecticut accent, allow him
to
talk.
Calm you down, and then 10 minutes later, you'd be screaming again. Do what? We calm you down, 10 minutes later, you'd be screaming again.
So I'd be like, oh, okay,
if you hadn't eaten or slept, like, at all.
Yeah, no, I didn't sleep that whole week.
You hadn't eaten either.
What did I look like at that point, too?
You were thin. You were definitely scraggly looking, thin, wild-eyed. You know, you were definitely, there was definitely something seriously wrong with you, and I knew it.
Thanks, Dad. So interviewing my father. Okay, totally different experience than my mom. First of all, he couldn't do it in person, because he'd cry, and he's a tough Irishman. He doesn't like to cry, but he's a softie. And so we'd have to do it over the phone. Now, he exaggerated how bad it was, As you'll see, I ultimately am in the hospital for 1 month before I get my diagnosis. In his mind, it was 3 months. So whereas my mom is mitigating it, my dad's making it worse. So I had quite a kind of hard time figuring this whole thing out. Luckily, Stephen was kind of my middle ground. Every time I'd run it past him, he was like the goalkeeper in this. He was like, no, he's right, or she's wrong. So I was very lucky to have him in many, many respects. But so my dad sees me like this. I go back to his house. It gets worse. In fact, at one point, this is when the visual hallucinations really start. And I see my dad loves Civil War, Revolutionary War memorabilia. There's a bust of Abraham Lincoln, and it starts to follow me with his eyes. I see a kind of railroad scene. There's tufts of smoke that start to emerge. And at that point, I hear my father start to abuse my stepmother, all in my mind. But I heard, like, I'm here today, as real as it is today, I hear this. And so I barricade myself in a bathroom, and I nearly jumped out the window. He's in an apartment 3 flights up. But luckily, there was a Buddha statue that my stepmother kept by the sink, and it smiled at me. So I decided not to jump. I mean, a series of miraculous events that led to this point, be standing on stage here, and that's one of them. Clearly, something had to happen. My mom takes me back from my dad's house, writes a list of all the symptoms, and there are some other things happening too that no one's really noticing. I'm starting to do these strange movements with my mouth, constantly lip smacking. I'm also staring off and having these staring episodes. You know, my heart rate's starting to go up and down. There are other things, but the psychosis is so extreme that that's all anyone sees. My mom makes a list of all the presentation. She takes me back to that doctor. She insists that I get hospitalized. Luckily, there's one bed open on an epilepsy unit at NYU. We race there, and I think probably everyone here, I mean, show of hands, how many people have waited for a hospital bed? Right, a good majority, I would say. I've found a way around it. Have a seizure in the waiting room. They'll get you into a room, they'll get you to a bed really fast. So that was my experience. So I get whisked up to a AMU, advanced monitoring unit, on the epilepsy floor. And there, the psychosis heightens. Because now, I'm not in a kind of familiar place like my childhood home. Now I'm in a very foreign place with 3 other patients, with 3 other sets of doctors, 3 other sets of nurses, 3 other sets of, you know, parents and friends and family. And it was so much activity that it got worse. And I actually have, strangely, in a way, I have video of one of my hallucinations, because the hospital, because it was at an epilepsy floor, they have cameras, and they were nice enough to give me that footage. So I'm gonna play you just a snippet of that footage.
Oh, great. Do you have a
trunk?
I don't know if you heard that. You see what it says up there. It says, I'm on the news. I remember, actually, this hallucination, delusion, etc. This actually stemmed from my father. And I now believe that my father had murdered my stepmother, and that the nurses were undercover reporters, and the other patients were undercover reporters, and I actually saw it on the news. And I remember this all very vaguely. It's all kind of strange mash, because in recreating it, you destroy the original memory, but I know enough that that's what was going on, so it's a strange kind of place to be where I remember these visuals, but I don't trust them. But that was what was going on. Of course, the hospital sees someone acutely psychotic, and increases the doses of antipsychotic medication and puts me in a chest posy, which is basically a restraint because I am actually trying to escape and very violent and had to have a one-to-one guard in my room. I was moved to a private room. I was not a difficult patient. In fact, I went back to the floor years later. I've been several times, but years later, another person who had autoimmune encephalitis on that floor, I visited her, and the nurses were all like, "You're not as bad as Susannah." They all kept saying, "I can't be as bad as Susannah." And then when I finally came there, it was just kind of like, "Oh, this is the worst patient," you know. So I had that feeling. But so this is the kind of intake, and then the rule-out diagnosis at the time. Nothing was quite making sense. All the tests were coming back negative, negative, negative. All the panels, negative, negative, negative. The rule-out diagnosis was schizoaffective disorder. Because again, nothing was coming back. On paper, I was perfectly fine. They couldn't capture any of the seizures ictally. So they started to believe that maybe these are pseudo seizures, which makes me mad in retrospect again too. But that was the kind of belief then. And about 2 weeks into the hospitalization, it took a turn. But actually, before I get to my misdiagnosis, I don't really have to tell most. Can I do another kind of question here? How many people have misdiagnosed? Wow, yeah. So 1 in 20 Americans will be misdiagnosed. And some will lead to death or serious harm. And there are, you know, women, low-income patients, and, you know, these are serious issues we grapple with as a society, and I feel like most people here either they themselves have been misdiagnosed or they know someone who has been misdiagnosed. And I just wanted to talk a bit quickly about that. 2 weeks in, I take a turn. This is a moving video. Let me make sure. Yeah, it is. See, I never can know. I'm going to try it again. Moving video. No. Nope. Let me try it again. All right. Yes. Okay. Moving video. It looks like it's a still, as I just showed you, because I thought it was. I would sit for hours and hours and hours like this, with my arms like this, in these strange kind of like a puppet on strings, a very kind of very slow and deliberate in a way, but kind of inappropriate positions, uncomfortable positions. And when I would move, it was halting, almost like stop motion animation. And this happened about 2 weeks in, and this for my mother was the scariest part because this was progress in the wrong direction, right? This was the disease was changing, and there was no kind of idea of why. And at this point, again, these panels were coming back negative, continuing to come back negative, spinal tap after spinal tap, negative, negative, negative. Every test in the book, negative, negative, negative. There were slightly enlarged lymph nodes in my spine, which started to kind of get the wheels turning behind the scenes. So we were not told about any of these wheels. So at one point, the lead doctor on the case, who my mom loved, he's a kind of teddy bear of a man, warm, compassionate. And one day he just stopped coming to the hospital, to our room. There was no explanation. He just didn't show up anymore. And my mom chased him down the hallway and said, "What's going on? Was it in his case?" And he just kind of brushed her off and said, "I'm off of the case." There was no explanation of what was going on, who would take over. And she actually counts that as one of the darkest moments during this, was being kind of brushed off by a man she thought was going to save the day. In my case, I got very lucky. Another man stepped in and did save the day. His name is Dr. Suel Najjar, and my mom started calling him Dr. House. not because he's like mean and like, you know, curmudgeonly and has like a pill addiction, but because he is really smart, basically. But he's like the loveliest, warmest, kindest human being ever. And the first day that he came to our room, he did something different. So I had had every specialist you can think of come through, and everyone was kind of seeing it very myopically through their individual lens. People, you know, psychiatrists saw the psychosis, the cardiologist saw the heart rate fluctuations, you know, we had immunology come in and rheumatology, and all these people were seeing it through their lens. But it was the first time when he came that someone kind of put it all together. And interestingly, and it's unfortunate for medicine, is that it was handwritten. All of his pages, everyone else's pages were typed up, and his were handwritten, and they were impossible to read when I got them. but I eventually did read them, and in them you see the bed bugs. You see the one-sided numbness, you see the tachycardia, you see the strange abnormal movements, you see this whole broad picture, which again, only had been done in limited ways before, and kind of limited perspectives before. That was key to breaking this open. And then the kind of breakthrough moment happens when he asked me to draw a clock, and I drew the clock one-sided, which, for some reason, I'm tired of this clock, I have to tell you, because I do feel like, even though it was amazing, I feel like it was more his patient history that really led to the clock, if that makes sense. The clock is not a magical fix. I've had a lot of people in the aftermath of my book send me clocks and saying, I think my son has the same thing you have because of the clock, or this is a normal clock, doesn't mean I don't have the same thing you have, you know? No. It was the patient history. It was listening to the patient. It was listening to my parents that really led to this clock. But the clock is pretty amazing, I have to say. I mean, it's a half clock. So the clock revealed to him, okay, we have one side, we have inflammation, or we have something going on with one side of the brain, right side of the brain, responsible for left field of vision. This led him down a kind of path where he recalled a series of new articles written about a new class of illnesses, autoimmune encephalitis. First was written about in 2005, got its name in 2007. This was 2009, and he thought, this really sounds familiar. A lot of the symptoms sounded similar. And he sent it to a man named Dr. Joseph Dalmau, who at the time was at University of Pennsylvania, and he tested my antibodies. I actually got to go to the lab and see the actual spinal fluid, which was really cool. And ultimately, I got my answer. I was diagnosed with anti-NMDA receptor autoimmune encephalitis, which is when your immune system begins to target the NMDA receptors of the brain. And that creates a lot of learning, memory, and behavioral issues. So, treatment. What are the treatment involved? And I imagine, can I ask another? I'm sorry to keep asking. I'm very interested in this group. How many people here have autoimmune or autoimmune-related conditions? I'm curious. How many people look at this list and be like, oh, I've been on that stuff? I imagine a lot of people here. Yeah, I feel like intravenous steroids are probably something that a lot of people, and the good and the bad that come with intravenous steroids. But this was my treatment, and we had a name. I left the hospital, and then what? You have a name. I have a condition that I was a 217th person to ever have it. There's no natural history of the illness. What does it mean? My doctor said, with luck, I feel like she could get 80% of her cognitive abilities back. And if my parents were betting people, they would have taken those at that time. And when I was in the end of the hospital, I couldn't walk on my own. I wasn't speaking. They would have taken those. But the truth was, no one knew. And so, you know, we started to hear all these strange words. And again, I'm sure many of you guys have encountered these strange words. Like, the next available appointment is in 6 months. We love that. Or we don't know, you know, PubMed, huge help in a lot of things. But you know, these things like paraneoplastic, phagocytes, all these other things are thrown at you, and then you're expected to become master them. And guess what? Many of us do. Like, now I feel like I'm kind of I know so much more about the body because I had this rare illness. I'm kind of armored with this knowledge that I didn't have before. But it's still a sense of knowledge is one thing. Knowing the words, knowing what an antibody titer is one thing, right? But knowing where you are in the kind of range of recovery, what's going to happen? That question mark of where will I be? That was the hardest part for me. So in this whole experience, as bad as the psychosis was, as hard as it was not knowing what was going through, the question of like where would I end up plagued me the most, and that's recovery. And I imagine here, you know, many people can relate to that. What does it mean after the fact? And how does it feel to navigate the world when you feel broken? And I remember when I recovered a lot, and a few months after I was released, I went to Starbucks to order a cup of coffee. And I found it so overwhelming. I had to count the change. I had to interact with the barista. I had to tune out the music. There were so many different steps to getting that cup of coffee that I had never even acknowledged or even thought about before. And this new world was so terrifying to me and so uncertain. And so for me, these step forward and step backs were absolutely the hardest time in this whole process. And I remember I actually started keeping a journal about two, three months after I was diagnosed, I could write again. And one of the first things I wrote was, gross. I wrote on June 16th, I make myself sick. I was so mad at my body, at myself. And I had gained a lot of weight. I was on a lot of antipsychotics. I was on steroids. And it was so interesting how I kind of obsessed over that. So I didn't have to ask the larger questions of like, where am I in this stage of recovery? So I went to a wedding a few months after my diagnosis. And I was originally invited to be a bridesmaid in this wedding. And then I was uninvited to be a bridesmaid in the wedding because she felt that I maybe couldn't handle it. I couldn't handle the responsibilities of being a bridesmaid. But I don't know if the responsibilities of being a bridesmaid are that high, but I have to tell you, it really hurt me. Because suddenly I was someone who they didn't want in their wedding party, that they were embarrassed of, or they thought I couldn't even handle that. I mean, I felt terrible about myself, and it was such a strange thing. I didn't even want to be a bridesmaid in this wedding, but I felt terrible about myself that she didn't want me. So I took that blue dress, as you see here, all the other women in blue dresses, returned it, and went to Ann Taylor, and my mission was to find the brightest, pinkest, tightest dress I possibly could, and I think I did a good job. I mean, Ann Taylor's not the place to find that kind of stuff, but I think I did a decent job, but I had a great time at this wedding. It was like my coming out party. I was dancing, and I had a drink, even though I shouldn't have, and you know, I just was really feeling myself, and I felt great. And there was a process of going back that's involved with writing a book about an illness. And I, in a way, I really, really wish I allowed that memory to remain intact, but I had to go back to that memory. And so I interviewed everyone at the wedding, or not everyone, but many of the people at the wedding, and the consensus was everyone felt sorry for me. They pitied me. In fact, one person went up to my mother and said, "It's so sad, Susannah's lost her spark." That was devastating to her, you know? And in my mind, I was sparkling everywhere. I was like, sparkles. But that apparently wasn't how people saw me. They saw me robotic, and I was perma-smile, and I had that steroid kind of, you know, chunky cheek look. And it's a hard thing to kind of think about how I felt then, but how others were really seeing me. And so there was these strange moments in writing this book, and that definitely was one of them. And there have been various points that were setbacks in my recovery. I'm going to read just a really short piece of the book. Now, this is months later. This is when, in a way, I'm navigating the world as a well person. It's like I'm passing. You know, no one can see that what's going on, but there's a lot going on inside, and there's a lot of uncertainty, and there was a lot of self-doubt. So I decided to take a spin class to address what I was calling myself a roasted pig then. I was very, very unkind to myself. And found myself on a bike next to my high school field hockey coach, who kept looking over, trying to place me. I avoided her gaze, craning my neck to the right, but there I saw two younger girls from high school, also riding bikes. I wondered if they were laughing privately about how fat I was, and if they snickered about how I was living with my parents. This is, again, all coming from my own insecurities. I felt such shame, but at the time, I couldn't put my finger on the exact reason. Now, I think that this shame emerged out of the precarious balancing act between fear of loss and acceptance of loss. Yes, I could once again read and write and make to-do lists, but I had lost confidence in a sense of self. Who am I? Am I a person who cowers in fear at the back of a spin class, avoiding everyone's gaze? This uncertainty about who I am, this confusion over where I truly was in the timeline of my illness and recovery was ultimately the deeper source of the shame. A part of my soul believed that I would never be myself again, the carefree, confident Susannah. How are you? People continued to ask me constantly. How was I? I didn't even know who I was anymore. So I had a lot of this kind of crisis of the soul through that time, but there were little gifts that happened. throughout this time. One of them was in the mail receiving a ring that I lost, and I'm not wearing it now because my pregnancy, I just had twins and it doesn't fit. So I feel weirdly naked without it. But this ring came back to me in the mail. I had left it when I got an MRI in the beginning of my illness. And then all of a sudden, it was in the mail, sent back to me. I don't know how. These little universe signs were kind of sending these messages to me. That's how I felt at the time. And I returned to work about 7 months, 8 months after my diagnosis. Far too early, actually. I was not ready. And the Post were so kind to me. They gave me stories like, write about the hottest bartender in New York City, very sweet, here are the easy stories. And they would rewrite it, and they would sit with me and figure out the 5 W's again. They were so kind. And at one point, one of my editors came with me to a grand rounds Dr. Najjar was doing about my case. And we walked in late, and this is what I see on the screen. I'm like, I have no idea what that is. And then I realized they're talking about my brain. This is a sample of my brain. They had done a brain biopsy in the hospital. And now my brain was in a room full of people. People were saying, it was such a strange feeling of vulnerability. My brain is on the screen. And now my brain is on the screen as well. So my editor heard this talk and said, you've got to write a piece about this for the Post. And so I did. Unfortunately, it was Tuesday when he became aware of this. It was due on Friday. So I wrote it. There are a lot of mistakes in the original article because I don't remember so much of it, but it came out as my mysterious lost month of madness. And it was published in October 2009, and I was inundated with people emailing me from all over the world thinking, I think I might have this thing, I'm going through something. I mean, so many people wanted to connect over this story. And I realized, there's more to this. I have to write a book about this. I have to interrogate this further. And my book came out, and one of the places I ended up was the Today Show, and I'm just going to play you a little bit of the outcome of what happened when I went on the Today Show. But before I get to that, actually, this is the number of papers published on autoimmune encephalitis per year. The year that I was sick was 2009. Look now. There's over 200 papers. There were less than 50, far less than 50, in 2009. And this kind of exponential growth. And I believe that sharing our stories somewhat kind of, had an effect on this. Sharing the story, being public about this, increased in interest. So I just wanted to kind of put that out there because I know so many of you kind of want to be involved in that kind of academic push. And this was something that was kind of blew up in the last 10 years. So I went on the Today Show after the article was published, and then returned again because someone had watched my first Today Show piece and got a diagnosis. She was one of many people who actually read my book or read my article and ultimately got a diagnosis, I guess. So I'm just gonna play this.
I thought that trucks were following me and people are out to get me, and I ended up checking myself into the emergency room and then to a psychiatric hospital.
After that stay, they actually told us that they didn't really have a diagnosis, but they were leaning towards schizophrenia. They said, she's never going to be able to work. She's never going to be able to go back to school. My sister, who lives in Wayne, Pennsylvania, called me at work one morning and said, I saw this incredible young woman named Susannah Cahalan that was on the Today Show this morning, and she has this terrible disease that it sounds exactly like what Emily's been going through.
Well, I think that there are so many people out there, I mean, who knows how many people out there are suffering from what I suffered from and are just not getting the diagnosis that they need.
After watching the Today segment and reading more about Susannah's story, her parents told Emily's psychiatrist about Susannah's rare disease, anti-NMDAR encephalitis. But according to her parents, Emily's doctors didn't see the connection. Her condition became critical, and a year after Emily first went to the hospital, she could no longer walk or talk.
She got a blood clot in her brain and became critical. She was dying. I remembered the article that Susannah had written in the New York Post, and I handed it to him and I asked him to test Emily. I said, would you please test her for this? And it was about an hour later that they put her on the helicopter and took her to the University of Pennsylvania to be treated by the same doctor that determined what was wrong with Susannah and to save her life.
Emily was on her way to a life-saving treatment just in the nick of time.
Emily's doing amazing. She went to... It still gets me. It happened a long time ago. She's graduated graduate school. She just got married. She's doing amazingly well. I became addicted to this, right? I mean, how can you not want to share your story more, right? And I'm telling you, the probably thousands at this point of emails, not just people who were diagnosed with autoimmune encephalitis because of my story, and there were many of those, not only parents, people themselves, but nurse practitioners and doctors, et cetera. I became obsessed with this mission. I had a mission. I was like a missionary. I was like, I have the gospel. I need to spread it. And so I joined these two nonprofit groups, started to talk widely. I mean, I was counting it up a couple days ago, and between 2013 and 2019, the ones I can remember, which I did so many, a lot of grand rounds at hospitals and medical schools, I probably did 60. At least 60 talks just talking about this condition and educating doctors. That was what I was really focused on. Now it's more broad. I want to educate the community because I realize a lot of people have reached this diagnosis themselves or through a loved one, not necessarily through the medical community. And so I really put my all in it. And it was about a couple years ago that I thought, all right, I think my job here is done. You saw those papers. I feel like I've helped people. I feel great. And then this happened. I'm gonna play it. No, this is my new book, but we'll talk about that later, but maybe. But this happened.
And we're back now with Eileen Chow and her father, Dr. Paul Chow.
Last year.
Who was critical in helping to get a proper diagnosis for Eileen after she was in a coma for 6 weeks with symptoms of psychosis. They put her through electroshock therapy. They once again thought it was in her head. You asked them to do a spinal tap to consider this diagnosis that you had read about in doing your research in Susannah's case. You found that they had not done the test. You're at the point where you're preparing your wife for the worst.
Right. At week five, I can see my daughter is going downhill. She had an episode of complete heart block. From my understanding, complete heart block is the stage before cardiac arrest. She had respiratory arrest. She had lost 40 pounds. She's developing sacral ulcer. And I came home and I told my wife, I think this is the end. And my wife got on internet and found Susannah's book, found Dr. Najjar. And I called Dr. Najjar. His first word is, I know what you're going through. I'll be there tomorrow.
Now, he works in a hospital system. He's a doctor. And it took him that long to get the diagnosis, even now when it's these so many papers out there and some people have been diagnosed. And guess the worst part of this? I had done a grand rounds at the hospital there. I did a grand rounds 3 years before her diagnosis there, and it just frustrated me. So I realized the work here never ends. And, you know, of course, I'm talking very singularly about my experience, but the work here never ends for any of you. You guys are always going to have to advocate for yourself and others. And that's why it's so important to do these to come together with events like this. And, you know, I want to return to the ice fisherman. So, you know, I think the way that I saw it originally, I saw loneliness and frustration. I saw, you know, powerlessness. But I think that there's a way to reframe this picture. And I think it comes down to why we're here today. You know, if each of us are ice fishermen, making little cracks in this great expanse of our knowledge and understanding of rare illnesses. If we each make that crack, we each share our story, we each educate ourselves and our doctors and the medical community, those cracks might spread. And they might come together and break this whole thing wide open. And that's why I'm doing what I'm doing, and I'm assuming that's why you guys are all here today, to break this whole thing wide open and to make sure that everyone was as lucky as I was. I was immensely lucky. There were so many different factors that led into that luck. But my goal here is to make everyone as lucky as I was. And I just want to thank Global Genes for this unforgettable opportunity to be in a room with all of you. I feel such camaraderie here. I feel you guys get me on a level that most people don't. And I hope that we can all further chisel, you know, your own individual cracks in that ice expanse and take full advantage of the offerings here today and really have an awesome time. And thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
Awesome. So we do have a couple of minutes if anyone has a burning question.
Ask anything. I have no boundaries.
We have a question over here. Wait. Oh, we'll go back here and then come to you, ma'am.
Hi. I'm just curious, what was Dr. House's specialty?
Dr. Najjar, he's a neurologist, but he's also a researcher and an epileptologist. So he's kind of, it's interesting because he's hyper-specialized, but also very broad-thinking. He's kind of one of those wonderful cross-sections of both. And I think the research side really helped him with this because that brain biopsy, where I didn't get into in kind of in detail, but he did see inflammation in the brain biopsy, which, you know, he was thinking in pathology and in a way that maybe perhaps had he not had that research background, he might not be thinking that way.
Hi, my name's Barbie, and I saw on your diagnosis something about your hippocampus, and I was wondering if it was both sides of your hippocampus or one side, because I have a messed up hippocampus on one side. It's asymmetrical versus the other, and I have autoimmune disease. So,
what autoimmune disease do you have?
I have reflex sympathetic dystrophy, full body. I was in a wheelchair for 7 years, had dystonia, and I'm getting proper treatments now that's helping me be upright and walk.
Amazing.
But I saw that same thing on yours, and I have a lot of the same symptoms, so I was just wondering if yours was both sides or one side.
Great question. I don't have an answer. I don't know, because, you know, how do you know? Did they diagnose with MRI in terms of being able to...
I did a functional MRI of my brain at two different universities and a separate independent lab, so they studied it.
What it's interesting about this illness is that only 50% of cases actually show up with any abnormalities on an MRI. So my MRIs were totally clean. So I have no idea. And I actually, if afterwards you have time, I'd love to hear more about what one side hippocampus, because I'm fascinated with the hippocampus. I don't know if anyone's read the book Patient HM. Have you read that? You should read it. It's about Henry, Patient HM, basically, who's a hippocampi. Both of them were removed to stop his seizures. It was in the 1950s where we were like removing brains all over the place. And he had serious problems after that. He could not retain any new memories. And it was like every moment was he was always 23 the rest of his life, basically. It's a great book, and you'd be personally interested, I think, in it. But I'd like to talk more about
that. Thank you for the question. There's another one.
Sure.
Thanks. We have some questions from our live stream viewers. So one of the questions is, you mentioned that other patients contact you. What are these interactions like? Are they looking for support and validation, or for a doctor, for treatment options, financial assistance, et cetera? And what's your approach to those requests?
It's a great question. So, you know, it's all the above. And in the beginning, it was manageable, and I would respond to everyone. I'd give my cell phone out, and I was very interactive. But there was a point at which I had to step back from being as directly involved, because I felt like I was out of my depth, because I'm not a therapist. I'm also not a doctor. So I felt confused. And actually, part of the reason why I helped found the Autoimmune Encephalitis Alliance was to get a community, because I realized, which is a case to keep for here, is that people just want to connect with someone who's going through what they're going through, because again, the loneliness of having a rare disease is all consuming. So what I found was people didn't really care if it was me, they just wanted to connect with the community. So that was one of the reasons why I kind of helped put together that. And now I will 100% recommend people connecting with you all, because what a great community it is here. You know, and I think that, would you all agree that connection is really one of the most important aspects of this, right?
Question down here.
Hi, I just had a question about your lack of insight before you were diagnosed. And I know, you know, with psychosis, and there's a lot of lack of insight into that you are actually sick, because, you know, it's all a conspiracy, everybody's
right,
putting on this show. Can you talk about how that affected your recovery and being a cooperative patient?
Oh, interesting. Yeah, you know, in the beginning, I had some insight in the fact that there was something wrong. Like, I knew something was wrong, I just didn't know what it was, and that was a really painful part. But yeah, there is definitely a part of that illness where I don't have any insight. I don't know that anything's wrong. And again, I don't remember what that was actually on a day-to-day level, because I don't remember a good period of that. But I can tell you, like you said, I was not a cooperative patient. I think it did affect the recovery, because I was more cooperative, but
there were certain things that I should have done. Like, I should have done way more OT, occupational therapy. I really should have done way more cognitive therapy. All those things that I should have done actual therapy. You know, I should have done all that, but I didn't. It was a strange, I had a strange feeling that I didn't want to acknowledge my limitations. I wanted to ignore them. And I think that that probably isn't a function of the illness. That's probably a function of who I am. And I think that many people can probably relate to that. Do we want to take that two-hour test that's going to be frustrating and then it's going to tell me about how limited I am in terms of my ability to do analytical reasoning? Like, I don't want to do that. Of course, it's important and everyone should do it. But I felt a tremendous kind of pushback against that because I did not want to know. In some ways, I wanted to remain blind to that, even though, of course, I did know on a deep level that things were not where they were before. Does that make sense? Yeah. So I'm not sure if that was the illness itself or just my personality. I had that a lot with recovery. Like, I'm bad with names, terrible with names. I'm like, is that who I am, or is that a function of the illness? And I'm constantly trying to figure out what is what in terms of that. And in some ways, you just kind of have to go, well, that's who I am now, you know.
I love this question. Twins, how did you move on to live with condition? Are you cured or is ongoing treatment required?
Okay, so twins, the question was just twins. It's a statement.
Twins?
Twins, yeah, they're really cute. They're 8 months. I was on medication for about a year and a half after my diagnosis, and I'm not on any maintenance medication now. I do regular follow-ups, but I'm not. Yeah, twins. Twins. I don't get any sleep, but.
Way in the back over here.
Yeah. Your initial description had a lot of bipolar overtones, and is that a reflection of your individual personality, or is this something that should be considered with people that are diagnosed with bipolar?
You know, interesting question, fabulous question. In fact, I don't have an answer because my mom ran it by my brother. She said, does this make sense to you? And he was like, well, she's kind of like energetic and she could be that manic side. I mean, we all have symptoms. I mean, I feel like we all are gradients. Like, I don't think these are hard lines. It's very fluid. So do I have some tendencies that could be described as bipolar tendencies? Probably. And I bet you a lot of people in this audience who maybe haven't been diagnosed with bipolar have those tendencies too. Some people have depressive tendencies. Some people, you know, I think that these are gradients of the human experience. They're definitely not hard labels. But yes, to that point, you know, I think that obviously this, I believe that everyone has this illness in my world. Like, everyone should be constantly tested for this. So yes, I feel like with the new onset bipolar, they should be tested for it. But that's my individual non-clinical feeling.
I think we can do one more question, I think. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, so you mentioned that when you were initially treated, you were treated with steroids and that now you're pretty well managed and not on treatment. But do you feel that some of the work that you've done has led to an investigation of new therapies?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, maybe not my work, but the work in general. Now, I would not have actually gotten that treatment. It's a good point. Thank you. I mean, Emily, would you mind saying what your treatments were? So she was diagnosed in 2018.
Yeah, so what was the question? I'm sorry.
Oh, so what were your treatments?
Oh, so my treatment was initially they did misdiagnosing as bipolar as well, and then a lot of similar symptoms. But it's IVIG and then Keppra, and then.
You did rituximab too, right?
Rituximab, yeah.
Yes.
I think two of rituximab, but IVIG has been.
Did you have steroids as well?
I don't remember.
Yeah. I don't remember exactly. But yeah, I mean, the next looking, like, but you, to your point, is rituximab is now kind of on the kind of basic level now. Like, you would probably get, I would probably have gotten rituximab in that first kind of, there's kind of three levels of treatment, and they kind of increase the amount of suppression on the immune system, and they use kind of chemotherapy type agents now to do that. They weren't doing that at the time when I was ill.
So let's do one more.
All right. Hi there. Thank you so much for sharing.
What can I see?
Hi.
Oh, there we go. Okay.
My son actually has a pediatric neuropsychiatric syndrome, which is a very similar, it's called PANS.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Yeah, so his was triggered by a very routine common cold. Some of the children get it from Lyme's disease or strep infection. So I was just interested to know what your trigger was. Do you know what caused this in the first place?
Great question. I don't know for sure, but again, my own theory is that, remember they had those enlarged lymph nodes in my spine? So maybe I had a cold too. That, I mean, like your son, I think my trigger was some kind of virus that if it invaded most people, they would have been sick for a couple days and that would have been it. But in my case, that's my theory. Again, I haven't proven it, but because of those enlarged lymph nodes, it makes me believe that there was some kind of virus that was going on.
So.
All right, we'll do one more. No.
And also afterwards, I'm going to be at the, where is it?
In the pavilion, actually. Susannah will be in the pavilion with her book and available for lots and lots of additional questions.
Yeah, whatever you guys.
We'll do one more. And I know there are questions over here, too. I'm sorry we can't get to everyone. Truly sorry, but please do seek Susannah out in the pavilion.
I appreciate you taking out the time. Hello.
Hey.
Yes. So the question is in regard, you had mentioned that you now have kids. What role did your condition play in regard to family planning, and what was the impact, and how did you come, did you seek genetic counseling beforehand, or what did you do?
Fascinating question, and yes, I did. It's one of these conditions where it's a genetic illness, but it doesn't seem to be a heritable one, though autoimmune diseases in general are. They do typically tend to, and they cluster. So yes, that was definitely something. I don't know. I mean, I have to reveal my ignorance, and I know that there's a lot of people who are very, very deep into the genetics world, and they know a lot more than I do. But I don't even know if it would have come up in the genetic count. Like, would it have? I don't even know if it would be. I don't know. Basically, but I did do that, and we did go through that whole testing stage. It is an anxiety. There's a lot of anxiety that I have surrounding that, and that I had surrounding being pregnant. Because I thought, okay, this is not my body anymore in a way, and I kind of don't trust my body. And so I had a lot of anxiety when I was pregnant. And apparently that anxiety doesn't go away when the babies come out of you. I'm still dealing with the anxiety.
It does, that mom. Yes, awesome. So thank you for the question.
Thank you so much.
Absolutely. Yeah, you're amazing. Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Such a beautiful job. Together at our 2019 summit. So thank you, Susannah. Susannah, wait, come back. we want to offer you a small token of our appreciation.
Oh, thank you.
And thank you for your contributions here today as a donor, just being
you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you all so much for being a wonderful audience. Thank you.
If you do,
I go now.
If you do have additional questions, please do seek her out in the Exhibitor Pavilion. I would like to now introduce Meredith Cagle, who is our MC today, and she will provide some additional announcements. Thank you, everyone.
Well, wonderful. Thank you all so much. Hello, good morning, and good day and good evening to our viewers who are watching from around the world via live stream. We're so thrilled for all of you to join us. I just got a text. We are over 1,002 registrants as of about 10 minutes ago. Amazing. So congratulations. And thank you to all of you for spreading the word about our summit and getting more people here to connect. Those numbers do include representatives from 19 different countries. I met a lovely couple from Poland yesterday, first time to the U.S., first time to the summit. We're thrilled to have you here. Please come back and find me, too. I want to talk to you a little bit more and just say hi. We were able to give over 300 travel scholarships this year as well. So we're very grateful to our partners, our industry partners, who are able to make that possible. I'm going to do some housekeeping now before we head out to our networking reception. If there were still some questions for Susannah that were entered through the mobile app, we'll get those questions to her and we'll try to get them answered. She will, as it's mentioned, be out in the exhibit pavilion. We're here at a new hotel this year for those of you who have been coming for a number of years. And so just to, you know, for everyone's safety, we want to keep everyone safe. If there's any emergency that requires immediate assistance, do go ahead and dial 911 and then let a Global Jeans team member or a hotel staff member know so that we can let the team know here at the hotel. If it's something that doesn't need immediate assistance, grab a Global Jeans staff member. We'll do our best to help you out and see what we get additional help if needed. If there is any evacuation, somebody accidentally pulls or intentionally pulls the fire alarm because we need to go out, the evacuation is out these doors to the Bayview Lawn, which is also where we'll be having lunch later on today. Let's see, where am I? We're on the mobile app here. So some of you are already using it, downloading or submitting questions. Please do use the mobile app. If you haven't already, you can visit our info booth if you've had any trouble downloading it and need some assistance with it. You have the opportunity to make appointments on this app, connect with other attendees, can search for people with disease categories. If trying to connect with people with similar diseases, just enter that information and hit search and see if they can pop up. Request to meet with them, touch base with them during our networking sessions or at a break. Find speakers there. You also can see a list of our amazing exhibitors who are on that. Okay, we have 53 exhibitors this year, and they are fabulous. I had a chance to check them out last night. They're outside in the pavilion. We also have at the same time 26 poster presentations featuring work that the patient advocacy community is doing. Those posters are sponsored by Aldevron, and please visit them until 3 o'clock today. Stop by the Global Jeans booth as well to get more information, fun gear, Global Jeans t-shirts, and you can find out we have free tickets to the Padres game Saturday night. If you're still going to be in town, want to join us, please stop by there and we'll get you some tickets. Several of the Global Jeans team members will be there, and we'd love the chance to continue to hang out and get to know you. The next couple of days are filled with an incredible amount of educational sessions, networking opportunities, and exhibitors. It can be a little overwhelming. Your room may be a little bit further than some others. We do have a quiet room just out these doors and around the corner at the end of the hall. It's night. It's got some adult coloring books if you need to de-stress or play with some Play-Doh. I think there's some tea and beverages in there, and it's just a quiet place to be if you need to go have a seat and relax for a bit. So please do take advantage of that. During all of our networking times, I am going to figure this out. Can I just get the next slide? I don't know what I'm doing wrong here. We're hosting, in addition, if you're a little bit uncomfortable just networking, walking up to somebody and starting that conversation, do take advantage, if it's a topic of interest to you, to visit Nautilus 4 and 5 downstairs. Those are hosted networking sessions, so they're topic-focused or people who might have similar interests to connecting. There's a host in that room, so it's a little bit more intimate, and you have an opportunity to walk in and help people get you connected to others. We will have coffee and tea available all day here in the foyer, and thank you to AvroBio for sponsoring. Thanks to UCB for breakfast. This morning networking break is provided by Intercept, and beverages and snacks will be located in the exhibitors pavilion as well. Please remember to wear your badge at all time. It helps us, one, get to know you better, and it also makes sure that you're in the right place for meals and other activities. We do want to extend a very big thank you to all of our generous sponsors. I am going to figure this out before. There we go. There they all are. A special recognition to our exhibitor pavilion sponsor, PRA Health Sciences. If you were here last night, I hope you took advantage of their lovely pink cocktail that they were serving. And you can check out their presentations during our designated networking sessions. Our Champion of Hope sponsor, Horizon, Champion sponsor, Horizon, presenting sponsors, Eversana and Takeda. Our title sponsor and Wi-Fi sponsor, Mallinckrodt Pharmaceuticals, if you're you're looking for the password, it is on the back of your app. It's on the back of your badge. It is Mallinckrodt. You'll need to type that into the Wi-Fi, Global Genes 2019, and Mallinckrodt is the password. Our platinum sponsors, Genentech, Gilead, Illumina, Retrophin, and Sanofi Genzyme. Please check them all out, and our 45 other sponsors and supporters on your mobile app. Many of them are also in the exhibitors' pavilions. Please go up and talk to them. They want to get to know you. Finally, our grand ballroom right here is going to be separated by air walls to accommodate our track sessions. Track one is located in Grand Ballroom C. This is here. Track two will be here in the middle. Track three will be on that side, and there'll be walls up here. Track four is located next door in the Harbor Ballroom. All sessions will start promptly at their start time, so do try to wrap up your networking time or carry it on your way into a room if possible so we can get started. Lunch will be provided outside on the Bayview lawn. Thank you to Pfizer for their support. And should any updates come up, we'll post them on the app. Now go ahead, please enjoy the networking, and we'll see you at 10:30 back in track sessions. Have a wonderful day.